Jaguar did not build the best they could do. They built the best that you could afford to buy. That's a miracle.
Kevin, why is the head tilted?
Why is the engine tilted? Kevin from the Jaguar Club. They're just looking to get a little bit of clearance. Sometimes you rock an engine over a little bit to get an inch or two. Malcolm Sayer, his brief is ultimate speed through aerodynamics. So any advantage, run a dry sump so you don't have to have a deep sump under the car. We're running an oil tank, there it is over there. So we lose some room there, rock the engine a little bit, just get it as low as we can. Who's the great example of that? 300SL Mercedes. They tilt that thing over like 70 degrees. And so yeah, a little bit of tilt to the engine. A lot of folks may not even see that, Kevin, so good pointing that out. And what we see then is the power bulge is offset. It's not even, and that's not a defect. That's normal in all the cars. So it's all about functions. Malcolm Sayer was not trying to make an impression on us about how beautiful this car would be 50 years later. He's making an impression on, holy cow, these things like crushed it at Le Mans. So that was the brief at Jaguar, was get out there and win Le Mans. So great work from Malcolm Sayer. Great design guy on the chassis with Knight working on the chassis. And then Bill Haynes and Harry Westlake doing the engine development. So this car is just a trip. Here we see the three Webers. That's what you typically see on a D-Jag. Unless you have a factory car, then you really got the cast me out. You have a fin up here for stability when you're pushing 186 miles an hour, and you have Lucas fuel injection. Hold your booze. Lucas fuel injection, Maserati ran it, Jaguar ran it, Triumph ran it. It was effective. There was no electrical stuff going on in there, no Lucas mysteries on fire inside of it. It was all mechanical. Yes, that's why it worked. It varied mixture by vacuum, and it was effective. Effective enough that here Jaguars run it in 57, and our Alpha TT3312 1975 Sports Car Championships running on that Lucas fuel injection, basically the same setup. So effective, powered these cars all the way up to like 270 horsepower, 280 horsepower maybe. So super cool car. Yeah, I think a lot of us grew up with this as being a favorite car. It was one of mine.
It sounded like at the end of the straight it was starting to get up in the rev range, like there's more to go.
We're a museum, so we're not doing anything maxing, but yeah, it was really just getting on the revs.
Yeah.
Is there anything safety oriented about this?
Yes, thank you for pointing that out. What's safety about this? Well, we have our fuel fill there, right behind the driver's head, so that's cool. But inside, yes, there's actually a little iron bar inside of here. If you look at it, you'll see it's cross-braced. So there actually is a little bit of rollover protection here.
Under 5 miles per hour.
Yes. Right there is your fuel tank. Your fuel tank is right behind you. So.
Now, it looks like that hatch pops off, doesn't it?
Yes, there's a seat here. So, you have to have a four-seat car at Le Mans until 1937, then you still have to have a two-seat car. Le Mans is like a touring car race. It's for a real car. A sports car is supposed to have fenders, headlamps, full road equipment. It's not a race car, it's a sports car. It's a sports racing car. So, two seats, it has a proper seat in there. If you took that out, you could go joyriding. When Jaguar stopped making these, when they weren't as competitive and they really bowed out of the game. Then they were making these with an open cockpit, two doors, put a cover over the exhaust, lost the headrest fairing, gave it a full windshield and minimal weather protection, and you had that XKSS. Gorgeous.
Steve McQueen.
Who did? Steve McQueen, yes. Steve McQueen had one. So that used the short nose, which is this is. The later iteration of the D's had a longer, more aerodynamic nose. So short nose body, sans the headrest fairing, XKSS, and I think 16 cars before factory caught fire and they burned up all, burned up everything. And
well, they that held in by pins?
Two pins in the front and a latch in the back.
Kevin, did this car ever run at Le Mans?
No, this car came to America new. Third place at Sebring, ran other races. So it did get raced a lot. Dr. Simeone acquired it in the early 70s. He said the underbidder was Mick Jagger. There's a funny story of that, but I can't use the language here.
Curse them out.
No, not Fred, but the guy in the middle.
Oh, okay.
told Mick Jagger guy something, you know.
You guys need to have an after hours alcohol.
Yes.
An adult only, story night.
You're right.
That would be
a great
friend.
After
we tell you all the stories that we can't tell you, but.
Yes. And Dr. Simeone had a lot of them. And a lot of his dad's jokes.
There's a lot of crossover between the aircraft and the cars at this time. Malcolm Sayer was an aerodynamicist.
Lucas, fuel injection get used in any aircraft application?
Not to my knowledge. Gentleman's asking if Lucas fuel injection was on the aircraft.
They all crashed.
I never heard of them being used that way. I think it was always automotive. Where the Germans, of course, were fuel injection, and those, and that made it into like Mercedes.
Only two cars had it up to 10,000 RPM.
Now, I don't know if they're using vacuum control, if that's an issue, if it's hard to use the vacuum control in a plane. I don't know.
And then there's icing. Other problems. Yeah.
But obviously, we love this car. It's dynamite. It's a real handler. You wouldn't think you'd feel a difference between this car and that car for rigidity, for our little bit of stuff, but this car really feels stiff.
Back in the late 50s, what kind of octane
You know, at Le Mans, they all ran the same fuel. Yeah, they run the gas they provided. I'm not sure what the octane was. We get 110 from Sunoco. It's race fuel. Thank you, Sunoco. They're a supporter of the museum. They give us a gold barrel 110, and that gets us through our demo days. It's no ethanol, which is really big. High octane. It's leaded, so you don't want to put it in a modern car. You'll ruin your catalytic converter.
Yeah, I know that smell. I've been to Watkins Glen.
This is 9-to-1 compression engine. I'm sure it could run on 87 octane.
Yes. Now, when you point out 9-to-1. The thing to remember with an endurance racing car is you don't go for max power. You underpower your car. You understress it. If you want to run 6-hour, 12-hour, 24-hour races, understress it. So you need enough power to beat the competition, but you need to not go all crazy and blow it up. So, for example, Aston Martin in 59, Moss has his job is the hair. He's supposed to drag the Ferraris into a battle and blow everybody up, which he did successfully, and he had a higher powered car to do that. So they can get more power out of these cars. That's why we see later, we see guys that build cars 10 years later and get so much more power.
So lower compression for more endurance?
Yes, less stress on things.
Kevin, when you drive this car, you drive the Aston Martin, how are they similar and how are they different?
Okay, gentlemen saying, how's this similar or different from the DBR1? DBR1's terrific. Right away you hear the noise. It's like, wah! So it's just crazy. It turns you on right away. And it's real low and really beautiful. And it's a real handler. That car, Moss is noted for saying it was one of his favorites or his favorite. It's just a super quick, you know, we can lace these pylons at probably 60 miles an hour. You can lace those pylons. So it's really, it's a handling machine. I'm not saying this handles four. This will run rings around my Triumphs, of course. But I think that's the thing you notice. Getting the DBR1, it feels smaller. It is smaller. It's lighter. It's super nimble. This car's got more torque. The other car is 3 liters. They're about, you know, this is 3.5 liters. Not far off on displacement. The other car is on the triple Webers. But this car has really got nice torque. It comes on quick. The other car really wants to get on the cam. So you drive a little higher RPM even from what we do, just to get near the cam. And then we don't know what it does. So, but yes, it's super, super nimble.
What is the horsepower on this?
Probably around 250. Yeah, the later cars, the factory cars, fuel injector cars are getting 270, 280.
Does it have a lot of low-end power when you drive it?
This car is nice and torquey. It'll break the tires loose any old time.
Okay, and I know the early Jags had hood pins. Where are they on this?
At Le Mans, you had to have leather straps. So this car has mechanical closure here with a carriage key. So it has a latch on each side, and then you have to leather strap it. That's for the rules. But really, the mechanical latch is what's really going to keep it together. So I'm going to go see if anybody wants to hear anything about the C-Type. It's one of my favorites here, one of the Doc's favorites.